Divine Truth Book Group. These are discussions of books selected by Jesus and Mary. This book group discusses Through the Mists by Ephra and Robert James Lees. This is chapter 15, The City of Compensation. Hosts of this discussion are Mary and Jesus. The discussion was held on the 8th of April 2014 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia.
Well, hi everyone. Today I'm here with Jesus and we're continuing our series, our book group series, a discussion of Through the Mists, channeled by Robert James Lees. And we're up to chapter 15, which is called The City of Compensation. So we're just going to work through the chapter discussing what we see.
Yeah, very good. It's a very important chapter, this one, actually, in the book.
It is. Mm. It is. Mm. So up until now in the book, Fred or Afra has been, in the last chapter or so, he's discovered his life in the sleep state.
And that he actually had a sleep state.
That he had a sleep state, and Kushner is with him and has been talking to him about the truth about that. And
yeah,
this
yeah.
chapter is really an extension of what he's learning about,
yeah.
about that process.
Yeah.
And
in this chapter he learns a lot of very interesting facts that actually have affected his entire life without him knowing.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting process. And in fact, the majority of people who pass do at some point go through this process.
Yeah, mm. yeah. And this is probably why we felt it was such an important chapter, hey, because there's so much there in terms of relevance to your day-to-day life, as well as we're all going to go through this process.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I suppose I felt one of the big themes that Afra was trying to show through this part of the book was about God's love and care and mercy and the compensation that exists for the injustices of the earth's life when people are in their sleep state.
Yes, and it probably should be pointed out at this point that the earth life doesn't have injustices because of God's choice.
No.
It has injustices because of what we as mankind, humankind, do to each other. So every single injustice that we experience while we're on earth is totally the result of what other people or ourselves have chosen to do that are out of harmony with love. If we all chose to live in complete harmony with God's love on earth, then there would be no injustice on earth and there'd be nothing to compensate for.
Absolutely.
So it's very important for us to acknowledge that right from the beginning. And sometimes in the reading of the chapter, it sort of reads a bit different to that, that as if the earth life is somehow unique in some way and that there are injustices that occur here on the earth life. But we must understand that all of the injustices that occur in the earth life are totally the result of living out of harmony with God's love and out of harmony even with natural love here on the planet. So I feel that's an important thing to clarify before we begin. Once we understand that, then when in this chapter, when he's talking about compensatory effects, they are really things that God has always had set up, always, but things that you notice a lot when you hit the spirit world in terms of the contrast with the earth.
Yeah.
And that's what he's noticing now, that he's being introduced to some things that he never understood before.
Yeah, that's a lovely part in this chapter, isn't it? That Fred finally reaches a point where he really believes this sleep state thing exists, and a lot of his questions about the injustices that he saw on earth are beginning to be resolved for him.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that and also there's a lot of sort of side points in this chapter, isn't there? So while that underlying theme of God's mercy and love and kindness being demonstrated all the way through your earth life and all the way through your spirit life comes out in this chapter a lot in terms of what he learns, the reality is that there are also a lot of other things you can learn from this chapter about the spirit life and also about the earth life, and that's why it's probably going to take us a few hours to discuss this particular chapter.
Absolutely, so let's be clear that this demonstration of God's love, care and mercy is really compensating for the injustices that occur on earth because of man's use of his will, humankind's use of their will, out of harmony with love.
Yes.
So God didn't design it that way, but the
God designed the structure of it that way.
Exactly.
So that we had the free will choice and we could create a mess on earth if we desired to, and humankind generally desires to. So God created the potential for that to occur.
Yes.
But God didn't make that occur, obviously. It was our choice, humankind's choice, to act in unloving ways that caused all of these injustices that occur on earth.
Yeah. Mm. And really, to me, it's a demonstration of just how big God's love and care is, in that the potential for this to happen was there, and so he made provisions to compensate for that.
And God made other provisions to help us to get beyond that as well. And this is what the chapter is really a lot about.
Okay, so let's start. And
so the general thing this time is we're not going to read the whole thing, are we? Is that how you've planned it?
Yeah, I've planned it that we're just going to talk through the various ways the theme is highlighted throughout the book.
Yep.
So we're going to skip a bit around the chapter.
Yep.
Just because we find throughout the chapter there's various things that Fred says that demonstrate a certain point.
Yep.
So we're going to work through it that way.
Sure.
But just by way of introduction, I suppose Fred finally, or Afra, we could probably start calling him by now.
Yeah.
he finally resolves this idea that the sleep state is real, and he actually comes to feel even that it's even more real than his earth life. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if that's a good place for us to start. So he says, that's on page 171, it'll be on 172 of your book. My earth life was not real. That was sleep. Sleep in which I restlessly dreamed of this. Now I am awake.
Mm.
And he says, henceforth, so now that he's passed over and he's had this awareness of this, what was happening in his sleep state, he feels that was more real than everything he did on earth. And he extends that by saying, henceforth I have to enjoy fullness of life in a condition where solution follows mystery as naturally as fruit comes from after flower.
Mm. So maybe we need to give everyone a bit of a background about how he arrived at that particular conclusion.
Yes.
Because the few pages before then describe the process of, he began walking through some vegetation, and as he came closer and closer, he was following initially, Kushner in this case, following another person, being led through a place where there's vegetation and so forth. He was looking at the trees and the plants and everything. And then he started having this strong feeling that he'd been there before.
Yeah.
And then as the feeling grew, so did his leadership of the walk. In other words, he started to walk in front of Kushner. He knew where to go after that. And he realised that not only did he think he'd been there before, but he had been there before. Yeah. And as soon as he touched this point of recollection, he realised things that he'd known all of his life, that he'd actually been in these locations for the majority of his life when he was asleep. So if you can look at the average person sleeping 8 hours a day, and he died probably, you know, as a guess, we don't know for certain because I don't think his age is ever mentioned, but I think it's in his 30s or 40s he died in the book. Then what we see is that for that period of time, he has spent one third of his time in this location. So obviously he knew it very well.
Yeah.
And this is why, if you read the previous paragraphs up to that point, he says, he looks around at a lot of things. He said, I think on my page, page 170, I know every one of these books is different, which is a bit confusing. Yeah. He said, in one flash, the clear memory of my sleep life had been restored to me.
Yes.
And around me lay scenes dear to me from infancy. And so all of a sudden he had an explanation for all of these different events that have occurred in his day-to-day life. He mentions on the next page, 1,000 impulses, strange as these, had been the ruin of my life in the estimation of my friends. And here he's referring to how he often thought he met somebody before, but he'd never seen them before that he could recollect, but he knew the face of the person.
Mm-hmm.
And then he woke up in the morning with feelings that I'd been somewhere and he didn't know where he'd been and things like that. And then all of a sudden, all of these memories came to him through that one single point of recollection.
Yes, yeah.
Which is an interesting comment about how the mind of the spirit body works, mm-hmm. and the brain of our physical body works as well, which we'll probably discuss, I'm assuming.
Yeah, yeah.
But if we look at what happened leading up, basically he's being led through this vegetation, and then he gets to the point where he knows he's been there before. And not only does he know he's been there before, he can remember all of the times that he's been there before.
Yeah.
Which is amazing, really. If you think about it, you having this experience that one third of your entire life had been cut off from you, and then in a moment, one third of your entire life returns to you. And people that you'd met in that life that you haven't met on earth return to you, and the knowledge of all of those things, it's quite an overwhelming experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which I feel he probably doesn't fully describe, but when he says, Kushna, my friend, I cried in my ecstasy, because all of a sudden I know it all now, but none of the revelations you've made to me can be compared with this.
Yeah.
So
yes.
It's like now he understands. Like,
yeah, and he talks about. He does talk about being overwhelmed there just before he says that, you know, that, but a great part, perhaps all of the mystery had at length been solved.
Yeah.
The key had been found.
Yeah.
Was it a tear of gratitude which dimmed my eye? So he's quite emotional about this realization, isn't he, of what he's really been doing. And we can understand why he then says, well, everything I thought was real wasn't as real as all of this.
And because he's now in that life permanently and no longer in his earth-based life except through visiting the earth through effort, obviously this life is obviously going to feel a lot more real and also permanent to him.
And do you think also he's also overcome by this condition where solution follows mystery? Because obviously on earth, Afra lived with a lot of questions. He felt like he was struggling to make sense of his life all of this time. And suddenly he's come to the spirit world and he's suddenly getting all of these answers.
Yeah.
And now even more to recollect his sleep state, he's like, oh, now it all makes sense.
Yeah.
A lot of what I struggled with, I now have answers for. And this idea of this compensation has come back to him.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I feel quite strongly that any person in this situation generally goes, all of a sudden their entire perception of their own life changes. Because he had quite a difficult life on earth. And like he said in I think it'll be page 171 in this one, he said he'd often, his friends thought he was ruining his life often.
Yeah.
The friends oftenly indulged him, and also his family often had pious fears about where he was going. He said he exercised the professional acumen of several physicians. In other words, there were a number of physicians who were worried about his psychological state or his mental state. And he said that he'd often been the subject of the devout prayers of clergymen.
Yeah.
All to no avail, because he had a very strong feeling that all of these things were true, but he had no facts to support them.
Yeah.
And this is a sad fact of our earth life too. We could gain facts to support these things,
mm-hmm.
but unfortunately for the majority of people, they never do.
Mm-hmm.
And so all of these things that they suspect is going on, now in their in their new life after they've passed, they now have confirmation of all of these things. And this is where a lot of the unanswered questions of earth life become answered in the spirit state. Of course, they could be answered sooner,
mm-hmm.
but for the majority of people, that's not the case.
Doesn't happen. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah. So Afra has come to this knowledge, mm-hmm. now, as we've said,
mm-hmm.
and he's also come to see, and we'll talk about this as we progress, but that in the sleep state, we have relationships and powers and a whole experience that we don't necessarily remember when we awake up.
Yeah.
And he, as you just mentioned, he had some inklings of these things, but
as most people do, let's face it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
But he's come to see this as a reality now at this point in his journey.
Correct.
And he also comes upon, he has a really interesting reflection, or a really powerful reflection, on the first page of our chapter. where he can see now God's provisions that we talked about earlier, and he can see the power of what happens in the sleep state in assisting to balance what happens in our awake state.
Yeah.
And he says, he reflects on the mercy of man, and he talks about a man who goes to prison on earth, and we afford him visitation rights and rights to communicate with the outside world. And he says this very powerful thing: can God by any means inspire an act of humanity he himself would be unwilling to perform? Can the creature, under any circumstances, manifest a greater degree of charity than the Creator? And this is a powerful kind of reasoning that Fred has as well, that that brings this reality of God's love within this provision really home to him, and how much it must be true, and how he even says, I couldn't even bear to think that for very long, but I did think about this.
Yeah, and I suppose if we're honest with ourselves, the majority of people on earth don't really believe in a loving God. If they believe in God at all. And those of those people who do believe in God believe in a very harsh God, one, you know, one that propounds a whole heap of mysteries without providing any solutions, is really what the majority of people, how the majority of people view God. And when you hear people talk about their religious faith, quite often they talk about the mysteries involved in their religious faith. And yet, if we think about it clearly and logically, it doesn't make sense that all of that should be the way it is. Because if God loved us more, and God must love us more than the average person on earth can love, if God loves us more than the average person on earth can love, then God would want to be supplying the answers to all of these mysteries and questions that we have. But there must be a reason why those answers and solutions aren't available to us at the moment. And this is where I feel most people finish up blaming God for that, rather than having a look at something going on within themselves, within their belief systems, that would cause their inability to be able to hear what God has to say.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a very interesting idea about the mercy of man compared to how much people believe God is merciful. Often people on earth are more willing to see that people around them are merciful more than they believe that of God.
Definitely. Where
do you think that comes from, that lack?
Well, it becomes primarily from the harsh treatment from the majority of people who've had during
their
childhood. Like during our childhoods, the majority of people have experienced violence from their parents, and that violence is often physical. So in other words, many of them have been assaulted by their parents. Many of them have been abused by their parents, whether that be physically or emotionally or sexually. And as a result, they have a viewpoint that is a very strong viewpoint of their parents, that the parents can be harsh and uncompromising and so forth, which is very true. But then they apply that same viewpoint to God. They basically suggest that God must have the same parenting skills as the average parent on earth does. And then they imply through their religious beliefs that God is like that, that God is a punishing, vindictive God who is going to bring vengeance upon any person who's wicked. And the definition of wicked seems to vary depending on which religious faith you're attached to. And of course, our parents' definition of wicked varied depending on what their personal beliefs were. And so all of these things create an openness in us to believe that God must be a harsh, uncompromising, punishing God, and nothing could be further from the truth.
All right. So let's then look at how Fred or Afra begins to see that God is very loving and merciful through his experience of the recollections. And the first thing that he talks about is the companionship and assistance that he received and that others receive when they're in their sleep state. So people who are often very lonely, as he was on earth, find company with people of a similar heart or desire when they're asleep. And so on the page 169, which would be your 170, Yeah, around me lay scenes dear to me from infancy. And he talks about how just this beautiful recollection of...
I like how he says it. Can I read it?
Yeah, please
perhaps
do.
Perhaps if we can read it.
Please do.
He said, how often I had awakened from my sleep with a dull sense of forgetting something, for the loss of which my heart felt heavy, but my memory was powerless to recall it. I had sighed to renew some sweet companionship I had formed in the vagaries of a dream. I felt confident that someone, somewhere, understood my wishes and fostered my foolish whims. But where and who was it? Some unknown influence was always working upon me to do this or go there. My friends looked pitifully upon me, regarding me as the victim of strange fancies from which I had not the power to break away. So, you know, he often had this whimsical feeling, yeah. I suppose you could describe it as, sometimes dreamlike, that he was forgetting something, that something had happened that he should recall, and that he would meet people, as he says later, that he would frequently, when he was visiting the poor, he would come across the face of some sufferer which was familiar to him.
Yeah.
And I had not seen it on earth, but I had not seen that person on earth before. And he often was conscious that if he walked along a certain street at a given time, he would meet such and such a one, of whose existence I was ignorant, apart from my strange fancies. But I would go and meet them. Yeah. So he'd actually finish up meeting them in that place. And yeah. There was no need to tell their stories. I knew them already.
Yeah.
I simply performed my mission and passed on. So all of these things were happening in his day-to-day earth life, mm-hmm. which confused and confounded him, but which were normal occurrences in his life. And because he allowed the knowledge of these normal occurrences more than the average person, they of course happened to him more frequently than they did to the average person, which meant that there were a whole lot of unanswered questions that he had, which needed answering at some point, but he never thought on earth that he would ever gain the answers to or solutions to those particular questions.
Yeah, because really he's describing almost a psychic type of experience on earth where he suddenly knows where to go to help someone. He feels like the people he's helping or engaging with, he's met them before and he's fond of them, but he doesn't remember why. And so really what we're seeing is the truth that if we have this desire in our heart that Afra did while he was on earth to help others and to have companionship with humble people, when he went to sleep, he had that experience of meeting up with them and being guided to help them.
If
I can read it, do you want to add more there?
But
this is a lovely thing that he says here, I think, and he's talking again about his life on earth and how everyone thought he was mad.
But
the unnecessary suffering and starvation of my fellows and an insatiable longing for something or someone which I could never define. A craving of the soul I did not know how to gratify, a hungering for some unknown sympathy for which I knew not where to seek. And that's really how he felt all of his earth life. And actually, he grappled with that and he got a lot of ostracism from that, but it was
so actually much so that people accuse him of being crazy. He was often with physicians testing whether he was crazy or not. You know, obviously a lot of clergymen thought it was totally something was wrong with him, and they prayed for him. And you know, a lot of the family members were upset with him about his belief systems and so forth. And then a lot of his friends thought, oh, he's a bit strange. Sounds like my life at the moment sometimes.
But it's
interesting how all of these particular things he now had a solution for.
And the solution was really actually a really beautiful thing that God had put in place.
And not only beautiful, quite simple.
Yeah.
Quite simple to understand and quite simple to see.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
And often I feel there are so many things that are simple to see that the majority of people on earth don't see at all, because we have such rigid belief systems and we're full of, you know, judgments and other hypocrisies, that we can't see what's right in front of our nose most of the time, showing us that something is different to what we imagine. Mm-hmm. And I feel that applies to pretty much everyone on the planet. Everyone, almost everyone on the planet has had some kind of experience that they have no solution for.
That they can't explain.
But they can't explain. Yeah. And yet, if they understood there was a sleep state and an afterlife and you had a spirit body, they'd probably be able to explain what actually occurred.
So
I just find, and this is where God is constantly trying to go, sort of poking us, you know, like poke, poke, you know, poke, poke, poke. This is something that you got to think about. And we go, no, 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 denial, 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 you know. We always are denying. We close off even our mind to the concept. Even when our feelings are telling us something different might be possible, we are so heavily intellectually based that we've closed off our mind to the concept of it. We've closed our brain intellect, our physical brain in an intellect, off to the concept, and as a result, we don't find a solution to many of these conundrums until after we've passed. Mm.
And perhaps we can jump to talking about that now, because one of the other provisions, I suppose, of God, these loving provisions that Afra is talking to us about, is that much truth is accessible to us in the sleep state. Mm. And he actually gives the reader a warning. He says, you guys, you make a lot of promises to people who are dying and you don't keep them. Mm. And you go to sleep every night and you meet these people and your hypocrisy is evident. So this is on page 174 now of... So that's probably your 175, depending on which version of the book you have. He says here at the bottom of the page, so he's talked about some other things that he's seen in the sleep state just prior, which we're going to talk about as well. But here he's saying that there are other memories of even more weighty import that he wants to speak to us about, which for the warnings they convey, I dare not pass by in my message through the mists. I have often been a witness in this city of a mother pleading with her child to keep the yet unfulfilled promise, which was sealed in the kiss of death, but since forgotten or ignored. I've seen the mask of friendship torn from the face of hypocrisy, heard the lying tongue convicted by its own utterances, seen the base intriguer exposed before his victim, have heard the yearning counsels of love to wayward children, witnessed the sympathy and affection lavished upon the unfortunate and the prodigal, and listened to the assurances of the presence of loved ones, unseen and unheard, in the hour of trial and temptation. I have seen the continued communion of souls, which the chill of death had no power to break, and the meeting of friends who, in their despair, had vainly imagined they would never look upon each other's face again. Mm. Which is a very beautiful way he expresses it.
Yeah.
But
maybe we can elucidate a bit further.
Absolutely.
The majority of people here on Earth are used to living a life where, if somebody doesn't see their day-to-day actions, they are quite basically either hypocritical or completely false in their actions to other people. So in other words, they live in a facade with most people most of their life. Mm-hmm. And they even see this facade as normal, while in their privacy of their own home or the privacy of their own thoughts, there's a lot of rage or anger or other emotions that they project at those people. And as soon as you pass, you can read all these things. Mm-hmm. So every single thing that you do at this point in time on Earth, if it's out of harmony with love at any point, you'll be found out soon enough. Mm-hmm. Because as soon as you pass, or as soon as other friends of yours pass, and if you're still on Earth, they will see the truth, no matter what happened. And as soon as you pass, you will see the truth of what happened with all of your so-called friends and your family and your partner. And, you know, every person who's ever cheated on their partner will soon find out about it. So what's the point of hiding it for all that time? You know, almost everyone at some point finds a huge amount of information after they pass which they had no awareness of before they passed, which would have completely changed their life on earth had they have known. And this is why I keep reminding people that unless you learn about living in truth yourself, and unless you learn to live in truth with every experience, with every single person, you know, the reality is there's going to be a lot of disappointed relationships as soon as you pass, because all of those people will know that you've been false with them, that you have not, you know, your feeling, your so-called feelings that you've described to them haven't been true. You know, that you've been hypocritical, that you've been, you know, often deceptive. And not only deceptive, but often just outright lied. Like you said, you're often condemned by your own words.
Yes, yeah.
You know, that you are a liar once you pass.
And even, you're referring there to once you pass, but even really he's saying even in your sleep state, these things are more freely viewed. And also, whatever you're living on earth now in your awake state, when you pass, you meet the people when you sleep, you meet with the people from your life who've already passed, and there is no, you can't hide it there in those relationships.
So this is where I feel a lot of people still don't understand, and a lot of people whom we talk to still don't really understand the importance of living in day-to-day truth. Because if you don't live in day-to-day truth, you will sooner or later be very, very disappointed with large amounts of wasted time on earth and large amounts of wasted decisions, things you could have decided upon that would have changed your life. Yeah. So it's really important that we come to understand that.
And that was something for our viewers I had for them to consider, which was to really think about what kind of relationships are you having when you go to sleep? There are people from your life who have passed. What kind of interactions do you feel that you're having with them? And also, we're seeing Afra had a certain set of values when he was
on earth.
And they largely, and we want to talk about this more as we go through the discussion.
Certainly.
But they largely dictated where he went in his sleep state and who he met there.
Yes.
And so for people to think about, you know, what are the values that are driving your day-to-day life, and how do you think that's impacting on where you go and what happens and who you commune with while you're asleep?
Yes. The reality is, for our listeners, the reality is that the majority of us are not in as good a state as Afra when he passed. When he passed into the top of the first sphere, what you would classify as an area near Summerland. That's where he passed when he initially passed into the spirit world. For the majority of us, we don't pass into that place. We pass into lower spheres because of the actions we've taken on earth. We pass into lower spheres. Now, as a result of that, Afra's experience was a fairly happy sleep state experience. He had friends, kind friends and beautiful people that he'd met in that experience. Not all of us have that sleep state experience because of our condition. If our condition is a worse condition than Afra's, and remember, his condition was pretty good. He spent a lot of time helping people. He had a he did not care very much about common world viewpoint.
He didn't bend himself towards, he stood by his principles and his feelings about love regardless of a huge amount of societal pressure against him.
And he did not feel ashamed of his choices that he made in his day-to-day life so much. He lived in harmony with love most of the time. He rarely worried about the projections of others when people condemned him or told him he was crazy or an idiot or nuts or any of those kind of things. He did not conform to the average society's opinion of what was right and what was wrong. He formulated his own opinions based on what he observed. He attempted to be loving in his day-to-day actions towards other people, and he passed into the top of the first sphere. And if we aren't living that kind of a life, we're going to pass into a sphere that's lower than that. Or into a location that's lower than that in the first sphere. Now, if we pass into that state, then obviously it means that our sleep state experiences are also going to be a lot worse than Afra's sleep state experiences. So we've got to bear in mind that in the book, while he describes very pleasant sleep state experiences, the average person on earth doesn't have that as many pleasant sleep state experiences. The average child does, but by the time we become an adult, a lot of those sleep state experiences that were nice are also dim memories of the past, because we have now tainted our soul with more unloving actions and as a result degraded in our condition, and therefore our sleep state experiences become more equal or commensurate with our true condition rather than what we imagine our condition to be.
Yeah.
So the majority of people on earth need to bear in mind that while Afrar describes a very pleasant sleep state experience, and for the majority of his life he had a pleasant sleep state experience, very many on people on earth do not have such a pleasant sleep state experience, and some of them have a terribly hellish sleep state experience as a result of their lack of love by which they live every single day of their life.
Yeah, and I suppose I would add to that that a person's intent and their aspiration and the use of their will is very significant in what dictates their sleep state experience. So totally agree with you that when we're in a our degraded soul condition, that's where our sleep state experience also exists. Mm. But the capacity for that to be a growth type of experience in the sleep state, one that helps and assists us, or one that further degrades our condition, is very much related to our aspirations at any one point in time.
Yes.
So if I'm living in my rage and I'm sitting on my stuff and I'm feeling really negative and punishing to the world around me in my awake state, then not only will I enter the sleep state at a condition that is equal to my soul condition at this point in time, but I'll be likely to act in very negative ways in accordance with my aspirations and my will while I'm awake.
Correct.
On earth.
Yeah.
Whereas if that changes within me, I'll still enter the sleep state at that same condition, but something totally different will happen, because
I'll choose to act more lovingly, choose to help myself while I was on earth,
and I will attract people who, such as Kushner, or you know, people like this who will come to where I am in that condition and assist me to work through things in the sleep state, and immediately becomes more as what Fred describes in his very positive experiences. But prompts and cues, then I'll have a faint recollection when I awake, oh, this is how I might begin to change or grow, or these kinds of things. So
so what we're pointing out to people is that you can, in your sleep state, if you had a pure desire to grow in love, you can in your sleep state set up experiences and desire experiences that help you in your awake state come to new recollections that you have not had before, which will also help you grow in love in your awake state.
Yeah.
So you can choose to do that.
Begin to face truths about yourself and about your life and about people around you and about even people who've passed.
Yep.
Your sleep state can become a place that you engage more positively towards having those realizations of truth.
True. Conversely, you can also do the opposite to that. What you can also do is you can choose in your sleep state to do very harmful things, set up harmful events, try to attract harmful events where you have more power, where you have a feeling of more power or control or other kinds of emotions, and you become more unloving in your sleep state, and actually set up events in your awake state so that you act upon some of these sleep state decisions and therefore worsen your condition very, very rapidly.
Yeah.
So you can choose to do one or the other.
Yeah.
Now, and people don't realise, I feel, that the majority of the times, if they're not choosing to act in a more loving way in their awake state, then it's probably the case as well in their sleep state that they're not choosing to act more lovingly. In Fred's case, he was choosing to act lovingly in his day-to-day life, in his awake state on earth. And so therefore, when it came to his sleep state, it was easy for him to act lovingly in his day-to-day life because he was living in an environment that supported the love that he had in his soul at the same time. Now, if we're the opposite of that, we'll find it very difficult to live in a loving place on earth and resistive to doing so. And then when we have our night sleep, we'll want to actually take even more dangerous actions for our soul and more damaging actions to other people. and more unloving actions, and therefore cause the degradation of our own condition as well as the condition of others. So we've got to be, we can't assume that just because we're bad in our awake state that we're going to be good in our sleep state, and conversely, we can't assume that just because we're good at our awake state that we're not going to sometimes do bad things in our sleep state for all sorts of psychological reasons. See, the average person on earth does a lot of things because they are afraid of other people finding out. Whereas in the sleep state, you're not so afraid of other people finding out what you're doing, because you see that everything is pretty easy to observe and see. And so many people act nice in their awake state on earth while at the same time doing terrible things in their sleep state.
Yeah.
And this is why we need to be very careful about our analysis of our true soul condition without taking into account everything, that every desire that's within us, every action that's within us that we desire to take.
Yeah. And this is where this is why I wanted to mention this aspect of will, because to me, just because sometimes we can't remember what happens when we're asleep, we have the same will, like very much a huge aspect of our soul condition is what we're aspiring to at any one point.
Yeah.
That it dictates so much.
Yeah.
And so if our aspirations while we're awake, regardless of our actions, you know, if our aspirations are negative and dark,
yeah,
we can't expect them to be any different in when we're asleep.
No.
And conversely, as you said.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, but sometimes there is this opposite thing going on too, which we need to be aware of because of the different emotions that we have in our awake state. So it's not always that we're doing identical things.
No.
So, and we need to understand this. So while if we have a really pure heartfelt desire to act more lovingly on earth, then it's highly likely that we have the same pure heartfelt desire to act more lovingly in our sleep state in the spirit world every night. But if we have a facade-based life while we're here on earth, acting more lovingly but really feeling quite different to that, then it's highly likely in our sleep state we're going to be doing the opposite in our sleep state, because there's no point of having the facade. So, you know, we've got to be very, very careful and honest with ourselves and self-reflective.
Yes.
And this is where I feel most people fall down quite strongly. There's very little really strong self-reflection.
I agree.
On earth. And as a result, many people make decisions in their sleep state which worsen their life on earth. Mm. And many people make decisions in their sleep state that harm themselves and other people quite strongly.
Yeah.
Fred wasn't one of those people.
No.
So.
But that's why I wanted to emphasise the point of it's not action, it's aspiration and will. And we can have very dark aspirations to suppress and punish while keeping a facade.
Yeah.
But in a sleep state, it's that aspiration that counts.
Yeah.
It's that will. Yeah.
Like if you could liken it, like... some people you meet, you know, that they'd like to slit your throat the moment they meet you. You know, there is so much rage and anger in them towards you that they, and the feeling coming from them is they just really like to kill you.
Mm.
Now, sometimes those same people have a smile on their face while they're talking to you. It's pretty obvious what they're probably going to do in their sleep state or attempt to do in their sleep state. So this is where, you know, we've got to be really honest with ourselves about what are our true emotions.
Yeah.
And if we want to exercise our aspirations in a different direction, then we need to choose to do so whether we're here or there.
Yeah.
But the beauty of the sleep state life is that we can help ourselves make that change in aspiration.
Yeah.
By taking certain actions in our sleep state, meeting up with other people in our sleep state that we can't meet up with in our awake state, and actually have interactions where we learn new things and we learn how to grow on earth as well. We learn how to make changes on earth through that education that we receive in our sleep state.
Yeah.
So we can be just as open to new education in our sleep state as we can in our awake state. We can just be just as open to new knowledge, but the majority of people aren't.
Mm.
That's the reality.
Mm.
And it's not until they have a point of recollection like Fred's having that they even have any idea or concept that this is possible.
All right, so really truth is available and revealed when we're sleeping. And this other aspect that we've talked about, that relationships can continue.
Yeah, but we need to say too to everyone that truth is available when we're awake as well, but the chances of it being more available than when we're asleep are highly unlikely. And the reason why is because usually in our sleep state, there's one thing that we're conscious of that we're not conscious of in our awake state generally, and that is that there is an afterlife, mm-hmm. that there is a world beyond the earth, there is a life beyond the earth.
Yep.
And we've met people in our sleep state who are now dead on the earth, but they're still alive in the spirit world. And so we are at least usually conscious that in our sleep state, it is, you know, we're conscious of some more facts about the universe that we're not conscious of when we're awake.
Yeah.
And because of the consciousness of those facts, we can see that there is a likelihood that we can make some different decisions in that place. So I think, but it's important for us to know that the truth is, all of this truth is always available to us. God's made it all available. Mm. It's just because, as we said right at the beginning, mankind has walked away from God, walked away from this knowledge, that this knowledge becomes unavailable.
Yeah,
and then of course, we live in denial most of our life on earth. And as a result, we don't know the information. Mm. And that's our problem. That's our main problem, in fact. If we knew that there was a life beyond this and that that life, happiness in that life, depended upon the choices we made in this one, I bet many of us would be making some different choices.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think that's why Farrar is so impassioned in this. He writes strongly in this chapter, trying to urge us to have more awareness of this and to know that the facade can't exist there, and that there are things happening, and that you're still meeting these people that you knew, and even the people who are still on earth with you, you're still meeting. And he's sort of urging us to be aware, because what you do now impacts not only what happens in the sleep state, but after you pass.
Very important.
All right, so a couple of other things that that he talks about here are about the leveling of prejudice in sleep and spirit states and the freedom from disability. So maybe we can just touch on those two before we go on to some of the other more involved conversation.
Sure. So with the prejudice, you're referring to particularly racial prejudices.
Yes.
And this is what I maybe can read bit of it so that he gets a bit of a picture. The first person he meets after walking through this vegetation is a person who is a black man that he knew in his sleep state, who had already died and was in his sleep state, and that he knew when he was on earth in his sleep state, he'd met up with him, obviously, and he came to know him. So Jemmy is his name, a black man. And he remembers Jemmy as if they spoke yesterday, which they did. So, because obviously the day before he died, he was had time in his sleep state. So it's not a major thing. Oh, it's like long lost friend, isn't it amazing? Yeah. I haven't seen you for the hundreds of years, or you know, tens of years in this case. But rather, it's something I saw you yesterday, so and they start chatting, of course. And in that chat, he raises the issue about the fact that of what this man, this black man, taught him, which was about prejudice. Really.
Yeah.
He says, I will mention one lesson he taught me, which I think must have exercised an unconscious influence upon me in the lower life. It arose from my expressing surprise that Negroes retain their colour in this life, the spirit life. The dear good fellow replied that it was all of the goodness of the Lord that every colour, as well as every clime and kindred, should be found in heaven. And then he went on, there were many people who hated niggers and thought they ought not to be treated the same as white folks. They won't go to school or church with them. They won't eat with them or mix with them in any way. But when they got to heaven, they would find that niggers were as good in the eyes of the Lord as white folks, and they would have to mix with them then. And I should never forget his glee when he wondered what the white folks will do if they object to climb the golden staircase beside the niggers. For there's a mighty long procession of darkies, he said, that are going up all the time. In other words, because of the oppression of some of these races, many of them are actually in a better spiritual condition than the people who do the oppressing.
Mm.
So many white folks are actually in a darker condition than the people they oppress of a different racial background. And as a result, there's people of a different racial background in the spirit world who are ahead of them progressing in love, ahead of them in terms of the spheres. And these white folks have to come to terms with the fact that it's their own unloving condition that has caused this particular thing to occur.
Mm.
So I like the fact how, again, this is something that Fred learnt in his sleep state.
Yes.
And this was something that in his awake state he applied.
Yep.
In other words, he was not, even though he lived in white London, if you like, he was not, he didn't segregate himself from people of different nationalities. And in fact, he spent quite some time trying to help people of different nationalities while he was on Earth,
mm.
because he understood this one important fact, and that is that all of us are equal. And he learnt that in his sleep state.
Yeah.
But he applied it in his awake state.
Yeah.
He could have ignored it.
Yes.
But he applied it.
Yes. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. I found it really interesting, just the even the question that someone would lose their skin colour
mm-hmm.
after passing, and even an assumption that everyone would become white. To me, that is such a foreign sort of...
Well, it's a terribly arrogant assumption, actually.
Yeah.
And it demonstrates the terrible lack of understanding that the majority of white people on Earth have if they have any racial prejudices in them. Because the reality is, obviously, God made us all equal.
Yeah.
And if we have any of that kind of prejudices, obviously, we already have a problem when we arrive in the spirit world.
Definitely. Mm. And he says, it would have been mighty harder on the nigger if the Lord had changed his colour. And I suppose that is just showing God's equal love for everyone.
Yeah. And bear in mind, this is a black man, I should say to the people listening, using the word nigger.
Yeah.
And it's written in the book. Because it is his terminology for how he was referred to mm-hmm. while on Earth.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, there are so many derogatory terms used to describe people of different races on Earth that in the spirit world obviously no longer are used because everyone starts to realise, once they get to a certain condition, they start to realise that everyone is equal. And in many cases, the people who have been oppressed are in a better spiritual condition than the oppressed. In fact, in all cases, they're in a better spiritual condition than the people who oppressed them.
Who oppressed them. Mm. And again, this is showing the compensation. Jemmy was in this beautiful city that Afra used to go to in his sleep state. And so he's someone who's obviously very oppressed and almost living in slave-like conditions, we can assume.
Yeah.
But in his sleep state, there was this compensatory provision that God had made that he could have some joy and some friendship with people who were truly kind.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think too, I find the term the compensatory effect of the sleep state still, you got to remember that Afra is describing it from his perspective. And my perspective is a little different to that, because my perspective is, we have the ability to have these beautiful compensatory things happening on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
We only don't have them on Earth because of humankind's collective choice to live out of harmony with love. Mm. And I can't sort of emphasize that enough.
Mm.
These things are not happening on Earth, not because of something God did, but rather because of something humankind collectively does.
Mm.
And we could have a much better life on Earth if we just chose to act differently towards our brothers of different skin colour.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I suppose I keep saying God's compensation, because these terrible things are occurring on Earth because of man's will, and God is trying to compensate for the lack of God's laws.
I don't see them as God's compensation. I see them as God's laws are more purely in action in different places of the spirit world, particularly in anywhere above these, you know, the top of the first sphere onwards. So more of God's laws are actually in action. So this is how God designed it to be. And it's only the human condition that's caused the hells and caused this hellish condition on earth. And it's not in some, from a purist perspective, it's not really a compensation, but rather reality.
Yes, I agree.
It's the reality of what God provided compared to the unreality of what we have created here on Earth. That everybody says, oh, you know, quite often in the day-to-day life, we get people making us the comment, oh, but you know, you've got a pretty utopian viewpoint of life. No, I've got a real viewpoint of life. You've just got an unreal viewpoint of life here on Earth because of what's happened on Earth. But the reality is, what you view as a utopian viewpoint of life, in the spirit world, anywhere above the second sphere, is normal. It's a normal life, you know, and it's a normal life that we've lived 2,000 years or so. So from our perspective, what we see here on Earth is not normal at all. Mm-hmm. It's very...
Absolutely.
It's very, very much in disharmony with normal life in almost every other dimension.
Aside from
the first, of course.
And I think I felt quite emotional about this this chapter in particular, because, you know, Fred speaks so strongly about things that I have personally felt. You know, the I can't comprehend how people can overlook what's happening on the planet right now, and how other people are treating each other, and I couldn't ever think that that was normal or right.
And anybody who does think it's normal or right has something wrong with them, actually. From a love perspective.
From love, their viewpoint of love.
Yeah, their viewpoint of love is highly distorted, and something needs to be changed. And only they can make that change. But this is what I wanted to point out, was that normal life in anywhere from Summerland above is completely different to what we call normal life here on Earth. Thank goodness.
Thank God, really.
Thank God too for that. But thank goodness. You know, we have done so much destruction here on Earth in regards to the creation of a normal life even. We have done so much destruction. And that's what we need to come to terms with as people. We need to see our part that we have played in this so-called normal life that we now live, which is very much in disharmony with almost every other place in the universe aside from the first dimension of the spirit world.
Yeah, and this is where something I wanted to call you back to something you said just now, because I see that anywhere above the first dimension of the spirit world, you said that God's laws are more purely enacted there. But to me, that only occurs because man has refined his will in desire, because everyone in the second sphere, for example, has refined their will in harmony with love to a certain point. And
yeah, but what I'm referring to
are better.
Yeah, but what I'm referring to is that the second sphere cannot allow anyone from the first sphere to enter it.
Yes, this is what I wanted to highlight.
So this is the delineation that God has provided in the spirit world. And it's actually a very helpful delineation because it helps us progress.
Yes.
Now, we do... The only problem is that change is really in some ways in the spirit world forced upon you. In other words, if you want to go to the second dimension of the spirit world, you will have to change your condition of love. Whereas on Earth, change is not forced upon you. If you really don't want to change, then you don't have to change here on Earth. There's nothing on Earth that is preventing you from changing, aside from the fact that you're going to live a very unhappy life and you becoming consciously aware of that fact. But because we view on Earth an unhappy life as normal, we do not see change as possible. And that is our problem here. Whereas in the spirit world, when I say God's laws are enacted more purely, what I mean is that because you can't enter the second sphere unless you get into a certain condition of love, there is a higher likelihood at some point in your future that you'll realize that and then attempt to try to become more loving so that you can get into that sphere. People on Earth don't try to be more loving generally, in principle, because they believe if you're more loving, you're just taken advantage of. You're manipulated, controlled, you get attacked, you get hurt, you get
used.
You end up with less. They have all of these false beliefs about becoming more loving that they then use as a justification to not be more loving. They, in fact, use it as a justification for evil. And because they use it as a justification for evil, and God's given us the free will to make the choice here to do that, which of course we still have free will in the spirit world, but here you have the free will to make the choice without seeing the immediate results of this choice upon your spirit body and upon other people's lives. Whereas in the spirit world, you will see the immediate response upon other people and other people's lives and upon yourself and your own life. Yeah. And in that way, God's laws force you to do something in the spirit world that perhaps you would not have done if you were on earth.
This is why I feel that growth on earth is, it's almost like I feel very strongly about it because it's so much more
sincere,
pure. They're the kind of words I want to use. Yes. And we engage our will much more actively.
And positively, we're going to grow positively.
If we're going to grow, because we don't have the necessarily in-your-face feedback. We have only our conscience and tuning into our conscience. And at times when we're growing in love, our conscience is telling us something that the world is rejecting as stupid, crazy, weak, dangerous, all of these things. And we see a lot of people on the earth who've done great things in terms of refining themselves in love and how that worked out for them is what a lot of people say. And so it's largely rejected on the earth. And yet really what we're seeing in this chapter is that there are provisions made for those people in their sleep state. There is a great deal of love. And
when you say provisions, again,
how can I explain
Well? See, to me, they're not provisions. They're the automatic consequence of a person's sole decision to be more loving.
Yes.
In the spirit world, they're going to reap the benefits of that. On earth, you reap the benefits of it too. But because the world itself is opposed, you get the attack of the world. Yeah. But from God's perspective, even on earth, you are reaping the benefits of a more loving decision when you decide to do something more loving.
Even internally, you feel
internally,
that.
But also externally.
Yeah.
There are things that happen externally, automatically, that couldn't have happened before you were more loving, that happen as a result of your choice to be more loving.
Yeah.
The problem is, on earth, we often receive huge amounts of opposition from people around us who are less loving, and that attack then is seen as as some kind of thing that God did or something like that. And so then when we go to the spirit world and we realize a great condition, we see it as compensatory, but really it's just the pure result of a beautiful God giving us exactly what we deserve.
Yeah, absolutely.
Whereas on earth, when we act in harmony with love, we do not always get what we deserve because the people around us are often very opposed to us acting in harmony with love. And as a result of their attack, we don't get what we deserve to have when we act more lovingly. Now that could change, but of course it's highly unlikely unless more people want to love on earth.
Yeah.
But I don't sort of see that as a compensatory effect in the spirit world. I see it as getting what you deserved in the first place.
as the laws as, operating as they were designed to act.
Well, not only that, as a beautiful God would do, as a beautiful person would do. God is a beautiful God.
Yeah.
God automatically wishes to give you the due compensation you deserve for everything that you choose to do in harmony with love, and in fact far exceeds the compensation effect through, because God is generous with the way in which God gives to us when we act in harmony with the loving with loving things. God's even generous when we're unloving, let's face it.
Well, that's the mercy,
because there's the mercy
it?
And forgiveness. So the reality is, when we act in harmony with love and truth, God's is so generous to us in the spirit world, but that generosity could be experienced here on earth if it wasn't for the fact that we're living in an environment that opposes that generosity.
And that again is based on the will,
collective will,
of the society or the race, the humanity we're living in.
Yes. Yeah. So while a person who's passed into the spirit world, who did act in harmony with love on earth, and felt the terrible wrath of other people as a result of them doing so, passes into the spirit world and then has the due reward of a person who's acted in harmony with love, and then, of course, sees that as compensating for the effects of the past. I don't sort of see it as compensating, but rather the reality of God.
Yeah.
God's reality. God is always attempting to give us exactly what the love that we have within us deserves.
It's the expression of God's will, isn't it? Whereas on earth, we're often living within the limitations of man's will. God's will is more present and tangible to us in our sleep state or after we pass.
It can be, yes. Of course, we have the option of becoming at one with God while on earth, and then God's will or God's desire to love us and God's generosity towards us we would feel all the time.
Yes.
And we would feel very different. We would see this big demarcation between what people choose to do to us and what God chooses to do to us. Unfortunately, on earth, we get this mixed up a bit. You know, what happens is, you know, bad things happen to us when we're trying to do good, mm-hmm. and we then go and blame God for it, mm. when the reality is, no, God's not to blame for the bad things that happen to us when we tried to do good. The environment we're living in is, and the people that are on earth who want bad are the people who are to blame for it, and God justly associates the blame to them. And God only wants to give us loving, generous gifts as a result of our choice to be loving. And we need to be very careful that we make this distinction, that we can see that when bad things happen to us because we chose to do good, it's because of the world we're living in that happened, and the collective will of humankind that this bad thing happened, not the design of God.
No.
Right? It's to do with the desire of the world,
yeah.
that causes that. And sooner or later, we're going to have to conquer the world.
Yeah.
We're going to have to get to the point where we through our own actions, conquer the world by conquering the world's desires. In other words, that we no longer have the desires of the world within us.
Mm-hmm.
And once we're in that state, we will feel the generosity of the God that runs the universe,
yeah.
and that is constantly trying to give us and attempting to give us the due reward of a person who is, through the purity of their heart, desiring to be loving. Mm. Not through some kind of facade-based action, but from the purity of their heart,
yeah.
wants to be loving.
Yeah. And that's probably something to point out about Afra and his journey in writing the books. He's describing how he came across these things. From his point of view, this is compensation.
Yeah.
And this is why it's awesome to have our proper perspective on everything.
Yeah.
But obviously...
And you think about it, for the average person, it would feel like compensation.
Absolutely.
Because they're living on earth, and every time they acted lovingly, somebody probably tried to harm them or punish them or tried to hurt them in some way because of all of their own issues. And so on earth, a lot of people feel like they're just being punished for doing good.
Mm-hmm.
When they arrived in the spirit world, they realised that every good deed goes rewarded, not unpunished, as the saying is here on earth.
Yeah.
What is the saying here on earth? Every good deed never goes unpunished.
Yes.
In the spirit world, it's every good deed is rewarded.
Yeah.
And we feel that. Like we feel that from an emotional state. You imagine that you realise that every good deed that went unpunished on
went punished
on earth.
Yeah.
Is actually rewarded when you pass, and you actually went through the emotion of that, you'd see the huge contrast between how the world works and how the rest of God's universe works.
And we'd stop blaming God for our pain and
Correct.
Start recognizing where our pain is really coming from. And sometimes that's coming from our own unwillingness to deal with our stuff.
Correct.
And sometimes it's coming from other people around us and their unwillingness to choose to be loving and choose to grow and
Correct.
Things like that.
Yeah. So we need to start seeing the world we live in as the unreality, just like Afra.
Yeah, yeah.
But we need to see that while we're on earth.
Yes, yes.
Because we don't change anything otherwise while we're on earth.
So yeah.
we need to see it on earth that we're living in an unreal environment, not the environment that God created it to be, but the environment that we, through our choices collectively, made. And we need to see the big contrast between, you know, no good deed going unpunished,
mm-hmm.
and in other words, every good deed punished rather than having every good deed rewarded as there would be under normal circumstances in God's universe. And it's only the people who provide the punishment generally for good deeds. And we need to be very careful that we need to stop judging God for the negative things that happen in our life.
Definitely.
We need to stop seeing that God is the cause of them. And I see that this is a major blockage in most people's relationship with God, because they still see God as the cause of their pain,
mm-hmm.
rather than seeing it's the choices of themselves or the people around them that are the primary cause of their pain.
Yeah.
And this is a very important thing if you're going to ever become at one with God, to go through this process of separating who actually is causing you pain.
Yeah.
And it's not God that's doing the causing of this pain. And we need to see that. And that's something that Afra started to feel now.
Yes.
When he passed. Like, and once he had this recollection of his sleep state, he starts to feel, wow, God never caused any of my pain. Yeah. All of that pain about judgment of my friends and judgment of my family.
And loneliness.
And loneliness and this terrible feeling that everybody around him thought he was nuts and crazy and all of those kind of things. They were all just people's judgment, but they weren't God's judgment of him. God's judgment of him was completely different. And the rewards he experienced in his life after passing.
In his sleep state,
proved to him that actually God was rewarding him for these positive choices that he was making, these loving choices he was making. Mm-hmm. Even while he was alive on earth, he was getting rewarded for him by every night having a beautiful place to go to in his sleep state.
Yeah, absolutely. And look, there's more to say just about some of Fred's questioning, but if we just quickly go over some of the other factual things that he talks about, mm-hmm. the freedom from disability, and he talks about yep. The blind man who he's observed him when he goes to sleep, suddenly he can see.
Yeah.
And so that's on 173.
Yeah, can I read the bit that starts just before it? Because I feel he says a lot about how he was often himself on the verge of atheism, which is sort of links into what we've just been saying.
Yeah, so maybe we should skip to that part of the discussion.
So skip to that part.
Because I've prepared a bit on
Because this is linked to this blind comment about the blind man and so forth.
Yes, please go on.
So here he says, I had learned to call the city of compensation. Sorry, I'll start earlier.
Yeah.
I thought there was a volume of truth in this simple philosophy which wiser men would do well to consider. That familiar phrase of the whilom slave, which seemed to come to his lips as the natural reply to every perplexity, it is all of the goodness of the Lord, is the statement, mm-hmm. led my thoughts away from the individual to the city which lay before me, the city so full of newly found memories and which, from my own experience, I had learned to call the city of compensation. In other words, in his own heart and in his own mind, this was the city that compensated for all of the bad things that were happening to him on earth.
Yeah.
Of course, that wasn't the name of the city.
No.
Because there are many of such cities in the spirit world in the first sphere, which everybody views as cities giving them this beautiful life that they didn't have while on earth. But he learned to call it the city of compensation because that's what it felt like to him. Mm-hmm. It felt like... And he says, owing to the fact that it possessed more features of that character than any other I could recall, more features of the character of the goodness of the Lord.
Yes.
So in other words, he started to see in this city how the goodness of God is displayed.
Yes.
And then he says, in my old life, I had been frequently driven to the verge of atheism by a fruitless attempt to reconcile the incongruities of life with the idea of a just and merciful God. Mm. So in other words, as most people on earth are, who are atheists and also who are not any of any religion, they see all of these terrible things happening on earth and then they go, how could God allow this, not understanding the gift of free will, not understanding what God has actually done in terms of helping us to understand that it's all about our desire. We don't understand all those things generally while we're on earth, and so we're often driven to the verge of atheism. We're driven to the verge of, oh, I don't even know whether to believe in God now or not, this terrible thing.
Or if God is supposed to be loving, where is the love?
Where is the love?
And if there is a God, that means that God must be pretty callous and I don't want to believe in a God. Like a lot
Correct.
Of people hold these kind of beliefs.
Without understanding the gift of free will.
Yes.
So this is where we need to have if we're ever going to progress on this earth and not wait until our spirit world life, we need to understand better the gift of free will.
Mm-hmm.
And because it's understanding the gift of free will, which also then allows us to understand completely why this life on earth is so problematic, why it's so destructive, what's really going on with it, and how our choices, individually and collectively, have added to it. And we need to understand that. Now I feel, you know, most people, when they arrive in the spirit world, don't understand that. Fred never understood that when he arrived in the spirit world either. Mm-hmm. So at the time of his passing, he often swung between this, you know, maybe there is a God, maybe there isn't God, maybe I should be an atheist, but I need to do good type of thing. But in learning, after he passed, he learned that there is a God of goodness and how much free will impacts upon this gift of free will being used badly, impacts upon our earth life.
And I think that's why he came to write the book. In a very large part, he was trying to help people understand what he had grappled with. He was trying to say, no, really, it's not all for nothing. And actually, your will does matter, and this is how much it matters.
Yes.
If we look at the chapter on the harvest of jealousy, I mean, he's really trying to show there
how much it matters
what we do on earth and how much it impacts on us. But he's also trying to say, hang on, there's also solace for the suffering that you see.
Yeah.
These people with disabilities, these people who are victims of racial prejudice and oppression, this is how much is there as reward and as care and love. And it doesn't even just start when you pass. It's happening in the sleep state. And so
every night a person who's oppressed on earth goes to a place where they're generally not oppressed, depending on their condition.
Yeah.
And if they are not oppressing others, their condition will be quite good, and so they'll go to a place that's quite good.
Yeah, yeah. And so these whole, in fact, the trilogy of books, but I think especially this first one.
Yeah.
He's really trying to show the impact of his life on Earth, how much he questioned and struggled, and then how many answers are just. And he's almost trying to say, here's some of the answers, you know, this is my gift to you, that you don't have to struggle as I did. And don't just accept what everyone says.
And don't just give up on earth. Don't give up love on earth.
Yes.
Because if you do, you're going to find a very hard spirit life.
Yeah.
And he, like, the thing is, even though he felt fruitless, often he felt on the verge of atheism, often he felt that he couldn't ratify things in his own mind, he still chose to love while he was on earth, and as a result, bore the rewards of acting in harmony with love in his sleep state and also after his passing.
Yeah. And I feel those two qualities, his integrity to love and also his desire to never stop questioning, even though many times he felt disillusioned with all the answers that he was getting.
Yeah.
Those two things made his passage into the spirit life and even his experiences in the sleep state, they made them so rewarding and so beneficial and quite beautiful, as he says.
Yeah. And that's when he gets to the comments about the blind and the so forth.
Yeah, well, and if we keep going on that vein, though, he says there, about the sin, about where was the justice in a life of vicarious pain which had its origin in another sin?
Mm.
So this kind of questioning, you know, you can understand his questions because many of us ask those questions.
Of course. Many of us ask the questions, but often then by the time we're 20 or 30, throw away those questions in a pursuit of happiness, or we could say in pursuit of our addictions.
I call it settling.
Settle for a certain life. But we often so now focus on just getting happiness in today. Like, so we want some kind of daily gratification. And in the process, we give up the analysis of what's really happening. And I find that quite sad, because it's only the analysis of what's happening in our life on earth that is going to cause us to change on earth and therefore cause some change to occur to other people on earth.
Yeah.
So almost everybody goes through these questions of, you know, why do we have blindness? Why do we have poverty? Why do we have people born into, you know, slavery or born into abuse? Why do we, you know, why do we have, you know, people born with no intellectual capacity? Mm-hmm. And why do we have poor people born in wealth? Why do we have, you know, like, these are all questions that the majority of people ask in their earlier life generally.
Yeah.
But then by the time they get to 20 or 30s, they're trying to ignore all of those answers because they feel there is no answer.
Mm-hmm.
And because they feel there is no answer, which is, like you said, feels driven by a fruitless attempt to reconcile these problems.
Yeah.
Right, they give up trying to reconcile these problems, and they also, in that process, give up acting in harmony with love. And then there's the damage. There's not only the damage to their own soul, to the souls of others while they're on earth, but the damage to their future life in the spirit world, and the damage to their children, and the damage to other people occurring on earth. It all comes from this giving up the concept of love. Just because we're living in an environment that doesn't understand love and is generally unloving, we need to hold fast to the concept of love. We need to have faith about love.
Yeah.
And this is where I feel a lot of people have given up. They've given up any faith about love. They no longer have faith that love can cure a multitude of evils. And they no longer have faith in the power of love. And they no longer have any faith in God as a result. So generally they become atheist or agnostic in their way in which they live. And as a result of all of that, they lose opportunities as well of changing things here on earth, but also changing their future life in the spirit world.
Yeah.
Because they've given up on love, they now feel disillusioned about it. And as a result, they no longer attempt to act in harmony with it.
And just reflecting on what you're saying there, that, you know, you're saying most people by the time they're 20 or 30 have kind of given up on love.
Hmm.
And I agree with that wholeheartedly.
Hmm.
That means in the place where those questions and that hope and that faith in love was inside of them, there are now emotions like bitterness, disillusionment, yep, anger, a feeling that I never get answers, it's never resolved, I can never alleviate the suffering, be it of myself or other people or whatever it is. And that's the thing that I feel many of the people who are on the planet at the moment,
yep,
and even the people who come to hear us speak, that's the emotional journey that they all face, is facing those emotions, where they gave up,
yes,
why they gave up, and allowing ourselves to connect with that emotionally in order to reconnect to faith and,
yeah,
and hope and belief in love again. Yeah. And without that, it's very, very hard to progress, isn't it?
Yes, you know, very difficult.
And
many people hold on to their false beliefs strongly so that they don't have to have proper resolution of those particular questions. In other words, they create belief systems which support the way the world is now,
yeah,
rather than support the fact that the world doesn't have to be this way.
Yeah.
So it supports the distortion of reality and then calls it reality.
Yeah.
So on Earth, we've got two problems. We created an unreal location from God's perspective, and then we called it real on top of that. And so most of us finish up growing up believing it's real. So not only did we create the unreal reality, we now believe the unreal is real,
yeah,
and that makes it doubly hard to change,
mm-hmm,
it. If we all started to see what we have on the earth as unreal, not necessary,
mm-hmm,
then we might develop some kind of desire to change it.
Yeah.
But while we believe it's real, it's highly unlikely that we're going to change it. It's highly likely we're going to live in disillusionment. We're going to live with the same feeling that Fred had while on earth that drove him to the point of atheism,
mm,
and as a result have no connection with God at all while we're on earth, which is very unfortunate for the majority of people,
mm,
to engage. Yeah.
Would you say though that the investment in holding on to that belief that what is actually very out of harmony with God and out of harmony with what is possible, we call reality, the investment in still calling that reality is to avoid the real emotional feelings of this disillusionment. It's sort of,
yeah,
like living in angry disillusionment rather than sobbing in disillusionment.
Correct. The humanity as a whole is unwilling to grieve. We're unwilling to grieve the effects of our own creation.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result, we are often holding on in a rageful way to, you know, what we now see as real.
And being realistic.
And we see that as being realistic.
Yeah.
And the problem with that, of course, is that we act out this rage that we have, that we're suppressing, that we're using to suppress the grief that's within. And the problem with that is we're never going to ever notice what's real after that point,
yeah,
unless we go through that process of grieving. So I feel humanity as a whole needs to grieve, and I feel future events will occur where that will be triggered.
Forced into grieving.
It's going to be the subsequent result of humans' current condition. we can't continue to do disastrous things to each other and then not at some point realise that we all need to have a big cry and get over them. You know, at the moment what happens is we all suppress our grief and get angry and then do another bad thing.
Yeah.
That's what we eventually do. And we do that collectively and individually. You know, the average person who's cheated on in a partnership cheats on their partner. The average person who gets...
or punishes their partner.
The average, yeah, the average person who has their child murdered goes out wanting to murder the murderer.
Yeah.
You know, the average person who's involved in a war where their child died, they want to go to war with the country that killed their child. You know, this is because we are unwilling to grieve. We're unwilling to forgive. And as a result of this, we create an unreal world. And our condition continues to degrade. And of course, we don't then experience the beautiful effects of a sleep state that can educate us away from that condition. Mm. So that's a really sad thing that occurs in terms of our life on Earth. If we had some hope in love, we would actually change that. But for the majority of us, we don't have much hope in love at all.
Mm.
And if we look at the average person we see even in our seminars, there's not much hope in love. You know, there's so many people who are without much love in their lives, and you can understand why there's not much hope in love, but it's mostly because we don't wish to grieve that the unreal world we live in is not the world God created it to be.
Yeah. Okay. Well, do you want to talk about disability?
We can talk about anything.
Because there's so much to say about this chapter.
Mm.
But basically, Afra describes seeing these people who were deaf and dumb and maimed actually be free of those restrictions
in
when they go to
sleep. Yeah.
And so I have a question from a viewer,
mm-hmm.
but also... before that, I thought perhaps we could talk about the role of parental injury versus our personal soul condition in the creation of disability and how that impacts on our sleep state experience.
Yeah.
So basically, does everyone who's blind, are they able to see when they go to sleep?
Yes.
Right. And everyone who has some kind of disfigurement, is free of that disfigurement when they go to sleep?
Well, disfigurement is a little bit different. If it's a genetic disfigurement, yes, they'll be without it in their sleep state. But much of our disfigurement of our spirit body occurs through the actions that we take that are out of harmony with love.
Yes.
And so we would still retain those disfigurements. And often a person who looks really perfect on earth has a large amount of disfigurement in the spirit world.
Yeah.
Because of their soul condition. So those things that are the result of genetic problems or imperfections or accidents that have occurred and so forth are not a part of our spirit body
mm-hmm.
and therefore we are generally not present in our sleep state.
Mm-hmm.
But those things that are a part of our soul condition, mm-hmm. those things that we have chosen to do out of harmony with love while on earth that have caused a disfigurement in our spirit body, they will certainly retain, they'll be retained in the spirit, in the sleep state. So you'd see them in the sleep state.
So again, this seems to highlight the issue of will. If we've used our will out of harmony with love, and that's resulted either in a disfigurement of our physical body or in our spirit body.
Yes, it usually starts with the spirit body first, doesn't it? And then
yes.
it may finish up in the physical body.
Physical body, yep. Yeah.
That's then why all of us die from old age. That's a disfigurement of the soul that caused that.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is impacted upon our spirit body and then eventually our physical body.
Correct.
Yeah.
Our physical body can no longer sustain its own life because of the disfigurements of the energy systems in the spirit body.
Yes.
And that's caused by the soul's degradation. So. Yeah. The amount of energy coming from the soul. So as long as it's not a soul-based disfigurement,
mm-hmm.
then it is no longer present in the sleep state
or
in our life after we pass.
Yeah.
But if it is a soul-based disfigurement, in other words, something done that we have through our own choices and actions out of harmony with love, then those disfigurements will be retained in our sleep state and be retained after we pass.
Yes, that's great.
Until we correct the unloving condition that created them.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you for that clarity. Mm. And the question was from Kay, who says this. She's wanting to know, after we pass and in the sleep state, are we still going to keep the disfigurements that we have on earth?
Mm-hmm. I think we've answered that fairly clearly.
Also, if a person suffered the loss, say, of a limb, does that translate to the spirit world?
No, so you still have the limb in the spirit world.
Yep. Yep. I'm smiling away to myself here as I'm given the visual of millions of people in spirit without teeth, me included.
Yeah, the reality is you probably have your teeth, unless it is a disfigurement of your soul.
Yes.
That has caused you to be without them. And then, of course, so if it was an accident or something happened and you lost all of your teeth here on earth, then, of course, you will still have your teeth in the spirit world. Mm-hmm. But if due to some soul-based condition that has affected the energy system around you and that's caused the decay of teeth and has caused them to be destroyed over a period of time, then it's highly unlikely you will have teeth in your spirit world state either, because it's the spirit body that would have caused that degradation. So we can't say categorically that everyone without teeth on earth will have teeth in the spirit world, and we can't say categorically that everyone with teeth in the spirit on earth will have teeth in the spirit world. It all depends on what is the cause of the disfigurement. Mm-hmm. If the cause occurred through some kind of genetic problem or through some kind of problem associated with an accident or something like that, then it's highly likely they will still have that particular thing. And nobody loses their limbs in the spirit world, but there are people who find it very, very difficult to maintain the operation of their limbs through their degradation of their soul. So it just depends on the condition of the individual.
Yeah. And this also, we talked, you and I, at some point about the obsession with all of us on earth on how we look and how things look, rather than an obsession on the true state of our soul.
And how our soul looks.
Because actually that's far more important for our eternal life.
Definitely.
Than how we look on Monday morning after 3 hours sleep or whatever.
Yeah.
If we're doing work and using our will in harmony with love, our soul is going to be improving. And there might be a slight lag delay.
There will be up to 7 year delay even. So if our soul is improving, there may be up to a 7 year delay in terms of how our physical body looks.
Yeah.
Right? Because the replication process of the cells and so forth all occur at different speeds. And therefore, the effect of our soul growing in a positive direction might not be seen for some time.
Yeah, and the converse is true.
Converse is true.
But in our sleep state, it's instant.
You will see it, yes.
You'll see it.
Your spirit body responds instantly to your soul's condition.
Yeah.
So you will see the spirit body's degradation or improvement, depending on which direction it was going in terms of love and your soul condition.
Yeah.
And so you will improve in your condition of how you look or degrade. And you can degrade or improve very rapidly in terms of your sleep state, but it might be a 7 year delay in your physical state. I find this topic quite interesting in a way, because as you know, I get criticized all the time for how I look and what physical imperfections I have still and so forth. And I find this quite a fascinating thing that people don't understand this very much at all. They believe that you should look perfect if your soul is in good condition.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not always the case. Mm. And the reason why it's not always the case, because you might have become perfect with your soul and there's this 7 year delay that may be occurring in your body. But also, it also is often the opposite, where a person looks great on earth, and often they have a terrible soul condition. And if a person could see their spirit body, they'd be scared of looking at themselves in a mirror even. And so I find this addiction to how everything looks quite fascinating. And we are on the receiving end of it quite frequently.
Yeah.
I feel quite strongly that when you go through emotional turmoil, which every person who lives on earth goes through at some point, there will be the subsequent result of it in your body as a result. Now, if you go through it and come out of it, the other end, with it all released, then of course your spirit body is now in a positive place compared to your physical body, and your physical body will eventually gain the same condition as your spirit body. If, on the other hand, you degrade your condition through the choices you make on earth, your spirit body will be in a worse condition and your physical body will eventually catch up to that. And this is why the majority of us die. So when we die of old age, the majority of us die looking exactly the same as we will look in the spirit world. Mm-hmm. Because by the time we've reached old age, the impact of our spirit body has had such a large impact on our physical body that now our physical body mirrors or matches our spirit body to a large degree.
Yeah.
And in fact, matches it so much that there's not enough energy to maintain our physical body anymore.
Yeah, no, this obsession with how everyone looks instead of how they act and feel is quite sad, I think, in that...
Yes. It's a major creator of facade, isn't it?
Yes, yep. And the perpetuator of facade.
Yep.
Whereas I know that as you open up more emotionally, the physical look and even the words that come from a person have far less impact than what you feel around them.
Correct.
And how much you observe in the way they treat others and the way they treat themselves. And
correct.
Yeah, so it's...
And also people don't understand the way in which emotional clearing affects the bodies. Because you can be in total denial of emotion and it not affect the body very much. And then all of a sudden you become aware and it starts affecting the body. And then you go through the emotion and that's when it affects the body the most, when you're actually processing through the emotion. And I've had like half of my hair fall out then, you know, like as you know, we've got a lot of hair cleaning up in our house. And then...
You and me both.
Yeah. And then once you get through and out the other end of the emotion... Your hair grows back and, you know, your complexion changes and your skin changes and your body changes and all of these things start changing for the positive again.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of times I see people, they go, oh, you look terrible. And I go, yeah, it's really good actually, because I'm at least processing through something now. And this is the effect of what processing does. You look terrible while you're going through it and you come out the other end of it and you'll come out the other end looking much better.
Yeah.
But the addiction to looking good prevents many people from going through the process.
Yes, this is what I was going to say.
Yeah.
That most of us get to that point where it's triggered and there's turmoil and we feel out of control of our body and how we look.
Yeah.
And we go,
out of its weight, putting on weight or whatever it is.
That's my favourite one that I always feel out of control with.
Yeah.
And if we retreat at that point...
Then we've lost the benefit.
We've lost the benefit, we've lost the opportunity, the potential gain.
Yeah.
If we move through it...
Yeah.
We find things that we struggled with in the past, like weight and things, become much easier to remain stable around.
Yeah.
But there's usually some loss of control issues as we go through it.
Yeah. I went through a period when I was working on some emotions that I lost 20 kilograms.
Mm.
So I went right down.
I've seen pictures of you at that time.
You've seen pictures of me. I was 61 kilograms and my average... weight is normally around 78 to 82 kilograms. And you know, everyone's saying how terrible I looked, how sick I looked. Yeah, no worries. I kept going, doing what I was doing. Because I knew that, like, it's not how I look, it's getting releasing these particular emotions that cause these things to occur that is the key point.
Yeah.
And this is something that Afra learns later in his life. Like he's not even aware of these things in Through the Mists, really. Mm-hmm. The effects of the emotion upon the body is something that most people are completely unaware of to many, many years into their spirit world existence.
Yeah. Most people don't know the gift that they are given through
truth.
Through truth.
Yep.
Yeah, and learning it earlier.
And learning it here on earth.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And we're so afraid of appearances that we neglect to use our mind even logically about the process that we're in.
Yeah.
And we have a tendency, whenever we look worse, we have a tendency then to judge that and condemn ourselves for that, which of course causes further problems, rather than just going, okay, this is the natural result of all of these built up emotions, which were all built up in the past, which I am now feeling.
Mm.
And this is the beautiful thing about progress too, is that you can measure your progress in your sleep state.
Yeah.
yeah. as you say, instantly. Yeah. If more of us were more conscious of what was happening in our sleep state, we'd be seeing either our degradation or our growth much more rapidly, and as a result, we'd know we were on the right direction,
yes.
or taking the right direction with regard to our spiritual progression towards yeah. God. But because most of us are totally ignorant of our sleep state condition, what we do is we focus on only the physical, and we're often focused on drinking the right thing, eating the right thing, doing all these things, which have no effect on the soul, generally.
Yep.
And so therefore, we finish up our soul condition worsening, and then wondering in our sleep state why it is that no matter how good we try to be, we're still getting worse.
Yeah, yeah. And that's something that I wanted to probably talk about, was to look at, you know, reflect on how when we view this earth life as all there is, what an impact it has on our long-term life. And we've touched on this already, but you know, Afra talks about this as well, that this thinking of the earth life as all there is ignorance and a false estimation of earth, which makes man attach an undue value to its condition.
Yeah, where does he actually say that?
He says that on page 174 in my book, which is 175 in yours.
Yep.
Should be annotated as two. He talks about having this new vantage ground, new vantage
That's right,
point
yeah. That perhaps if I read a bit of it,
yeah.
shall I? I was not by any means the only one who had been perplexed by such inquiries, referring to these inquiries about why are things happening the way they are on Earth.
Yeah.
But from my new vantage ground, I could interpret these problems in another and better light. Earth is not the omega as well as the alpha of life. In fact, it is not the whole, but only the part of the first, the alpha.
Yeah.
It is his ignorance and false estimate of Earth which makes man attach an undue value to its condition. Things assumed a very different aspect in the explanations my memory afforded in my newer state. So this comment, I feel that it is his ignorance and false estimate of earth which makes a man attach an undue value to its condition.
Mm.
And that's a major truth. We attach so much value to the earth-based condition without any logical consideration in many cases. Belief systems that are passed down from generation to generation are honoured above logic. And we see this happening religiously as well as in family-based and racially-based belief systems.
Mm-hmm.
Just passed down from generation to generation, no logic whatsoever. And as a result, we have a tendency to view everything from this earth-based viewpoint, which, like I've said already, is completely unreality.
Yeah.
And the problem with that is that we view it as reality.
Yeah.
That's the saddest thing. We see it all happening and we say this is real. And I often have conversations, and this is maybe an illustration of how this works. We often have conversations with people about what is normal with regard to the environment. And I often say to them, look, if you could have seen this environment 500 years ago, you would not think what we have now is normal.
Mm-hmm.
You would think what was there then was normal. And in some cases where we live here, there were trees like whose girths were thicker than I am long, you know.
Tall.
And than I'm tall. And humongous trees going up to 100 metres high in this region here, most of which were all cut down within the last 150 to 200 years. And now we have these spindly little trees, the maximum of which is about so big,
yeah.
growing up, and everybody says, oh, this is such a lovely environment, isn't it pretty? You know, no, it's not. It's not what was here before. It's not real.
Yeah.
And this is the problem with what we see on Earth. We have a tendency to look at everything we see on Earth and go, this is what is real, because it's what we see,
yeah.
but we don't see the history of it. We don't see how it become this way. And as a result, we don't know what is possible. And we lose sight of what is possible.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as we lose sight of what is possible, we lose sight of hope. We have disillusionment. And as soon as that happens, we have no desire to change it back to what it was.
Yeah.
Because we don't even have a concept of what it was.
Yeah.
And this is our major problem, I feel, on earth, is that on earth we do not have a concept of what our potentials are because we have long forgotten them.
Yeah.
We've long forgotten our potentials.
Yeah.
And as a result, we don't take action. To change what we currently have into what it could be.
Yeah. And so this was a reflection question I had for our viewers, was to consider how much of what is currently happening in your life you're regarding as normal when things could be much different, and how much also you're regarding the way you were viewed and your achievement, if you like, in this world on earth as the height of your success, and in what ways you might be sacrificing issues of love in order to maintain or create some sort of idea of success.
Yes.
Because obviously that has a huge, that's the perils of placing all of our eggs into the basket of worldly or earthly success.
Yes.
Is that we really don't look at the fact that there's a sleep state, there's a spirit life that we are living right now, and we're going to continue to live for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And if we ignore the qualities of our soul that stand us in good stead in those states, because we want to appear to be successful or appear to be, or to even get the approval of a lot of people who are in a dark condition themselves, then it's really not going to feel like a success in the long term.
Yeah. It reminds me a bit of a conversation that we had recently with some friends, and we were talking about professions that exist in the spirit world compared to professions that exist here, and the professions that are lauded or honoured in the spirit world compared to the professions that are honoured here. It's here on earth, the context of the discussion was that they were talking about how I needed to go and see a lawyer and an accountant. And I'm asking them why I have to go and see a lawyer and accountant. And they're telling me, well, you know, they're very well educated and they have good advice about how to run, you know, organisations and things like that. And I said, I can't agree with that. You know, I don't know of a single lawyer in the spirit world who's still a lawyer. And I don't know of a single accountant in the spirit world who's still an accountant, actually. There is no human law in the spirit world. There's no human number crunching in the spirit world with regard to money. And so the lessons that I need to learn about making something successful here far exceed the capacity of a normal lawyer and accountant on earth to understand. Now, I'm not decrying those professions. I'm just saying that those professions do not exist in the spirit world for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
Now, if they don't exist in the spirit world, why do we use it as a normal practice to go and get business advice from a profession that doesn't exist in the future? Surely if we're going to get any advice about our future life and what we're going to choose to do in our life, we need to get it from professions that do exist the entire time, whether we're dead or alive, the profession remains. And what I'm suggesting to people is that while lawyers and accountants have a role here on earth, certainly, the role has been created by the unreal universe, the world, the unreal earth that we have created. If we had lived and done everything in harmony with the way God had created it to be, lawyers and accountants would be a thing of the past. And so this is it's an interesting concept, isn't it? That even many of the professions that we have, that we go and get 4 to 6 year degrees in university to obtain, are actually don't even exist in other dimensions of the spirit world. They're not even real there. They don't exist. They only exist here in our unreal world.
Yeah, and that's something that you said in that discussion, wasn't it? That you might consult a lawyer or an accountant to understand tax law or man's law on
Certainly
earth.
I would do so, because they are the ones who... It's that environment that created that position, in fact.
Yeah. But in terms of asking them for advice on how to direct your decisions, you would never do
that. Or make decisions about your future life and what you should do with regard to your future desires.
Because there's a whole lot of other laws that are in play.
Correct.
Correct.
And none of them are man's laws.
No. And they need to be considered.
Yeah. So I feel, yes, it's very important to understand that from the world in which we live, from a universal, God's universal perspective, is completely different than the world in which we're going to live once we pass.
Yeah.
And also very different from the world in which we live when we're asleep.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And so still sort of rounding up our conclusion, I suppose, because we've been talking for a bit now. I suppose our Pharaoh really is urging us through the whole chapter to understand this sleep state and its implications. And so he's saying, like, be aware that you have relationships that continue even after someone passes. You not keeping your word has an impact. That relationship, you're still breaking something within that relationship by not keeping your word. He's saying that when you're oppressed but staying in harmony with love on earth, there are, you know, due rewards that you experience each night. And he also sort of encourages us to think, now, just consider, can't you feel those people who are still around you? Can't you can't you feel that those relationships are going, are continuing?
Yeah, I sort of feel probably, I love the way he sort of concludes the chapter in a way.
There's a bit more I want to say in conclusion as well.
Well, let's say you say that and we'll talk about the conclusion of the chapter and how he concludes the chapter, because I feel it's quite lovely.
Yeah, it is lovely. It is lovely. But I suppose that the other major thing, I mean, we've talked in this discussion about all of the, I'm not going to call them compensations anymore, we're just going to call them due rewards.
Well, he saw them as compensations.
Yes, I was using his language. But, you know, he's showing us that, that relationships continue, that oppression doesn't exist, that we have other powers in our sleep state.
And, of course, this is all if you're in the condition that he was in.
Yes.
So it's all dependent on being in the condition of love that he was in.
Absolutely, yeah. And that's really what I want to say at the end, is that his condition obviously affected where he, his locale in the spirit world. And there's this recurring theme throughout the book and even in this chapter that nothing is hidden in our spirit form and that the true man comes forth. This idea of the true man being revealed, as in the true character and nature of who we are, is transparent in the spirit world. And so I suppose that was another point for reflection for our viewers, is to reflect on the futility of the facade, since every night when we go to sleep, who we are and what we really want is revealed. And this is a true indication of how the real life is determined by our soul condition. Because Fred says, this is the real life. And I understand him saying that. He's saying, no, what is real is more shown in the sleep state than when we're here on earth. This is where we can be in a facade. This is where we can use our will unjustly and to oppress and be really unloving. But the true state of your soul and the true state of what's really going on, that's more real when we're asleep.
And I feel he's, in the end, he's providing encouragement and warning, isn't he? There's the warning. So if we focus on the warnings first, the warnings are primarily that if we, we need to understand that the choices we make here greatly affect not only our happiness here, but our life when we first pass over into the spirit world. They greatly affect what's going to happen there. And so we need to understand the choices we are making and understand that every choice, that's, every time we use our free will out of harmony with love, there is a result that is negative, whether we see it now or not. It is going to have a negative result upon our life and upon the lives of others. And there, we are going to bear the consequence of that, even in our sleep state that very night. We will bear the consequences of that choice because we won't be able to go to the same places we could have gone to before if we choose to do something that degrades our condition. So we need to bear that in mind. That's very important. That's the warning. The warning also is what you choose to do in this life greatly affects your future after you've passed. And there is a passing at which you will survive. Not, it's not like once you're dead, you're dead. It's not like that. Many of you hope that it is like that, actually. Many of you hope that once you're dead, you're dead. But the reality is you're still going to be alive. And everything you did up until that point will be known to you and known to all of your friends and known to all of your acquaintances and known. So if you're going to choose to improve your life, don't wait until after you've passed. Start doing it now. Like, start improving your life now.
Yeah, and if I can add to that point, I often have this visual of all of us running from trying to outrun our baggage. Yeah. All the things that pain us, all the things that, you know, get us down, all the fears we have, all the things we never want to think about again. We're trying to outrun it, and it's just there on our backs the whole time.
Yeah.
And a lot of us have that feeling, I think, of wishing that when we're dead, because we never want to face this stuff. We just want to keep outrunning it for all of our life, go for the next addiction, go for the next, you know, worldly success, go for that codependent relationship that makes me feel a little bit better all of the time, or some of the time.
Yeah.
Just keep going for those things until I pass, and then, phew, a relief.
Well, we think it'll be the relief of oblivion is what we often
think.
That's
what we hope.
Yeah.
But the truth is, it just gets heavier. It just stays there. And there has to be a point.
And not only that, now we see it all.
Well, yeah, I'm not even to the point where we're
past
yet.
Yeah.
But in our life, we're still carrying it.
Yeah.
And when we pass, yep, it's in our face. And we actually don't even have as much freedom as we did here on Earth.
To even make changes and make adjustments.
Yes, it actually can feel more oppressive, and we can be surrounded even more by people who have the same will as us to avoid.
Yeah.
And there has to come, but at some point in our life, there has to come a point where we stop running from what we're carrying, turn around, put it down and have a look inside, you know, and it's going to have to happen either here on Earth
or
when we're in our spirit life.
Yeah. Or it'll be forced upon you at some point in your spirit life.
Yeah, we're going to have to.
You can choose to do it here on Earth, at least. You can choose to go through it all, and you can choose to spend the time you spend on it.
But unfortunately, it's hard to pick, though.
Yeah.
You know, you open
sometimes,
it
but it's not that hard if you're honest. But I feel you can choose.
I mean, pick and choose what you want to deal with.
Well, you know, what I'm saying is you can choose to go through it all.
Yes.
You can choose to take the action and go through it all and therefore benefit your life immediately.
Yeah.
But also, every time you choose here to do something about it, there is an immediate benefit in your sleep state and an immediate benefit in your life after you've passed.
Yeah.
Every time you deny it, there's no immediate benefit in your sleep state, no immediate benefit in your life after you've passed.
Yeah.
So you're better off doing what you need to do now. Put the bag down, as you say, go through it all, with a, you know, what would we say?
With a fine-tooth comb.
That's what we would say, wouldn't it? Go through it all with a fine-tooth comb. Don't go, oh, that's a fairly big thing, but I think I'll try not to worry about that and try not to worry about that. But go through it bit by bit, really analyse it, because when you get the chance to do that here, you've now exercised your will in a very positive direction, which will have beautiful outcome in your spirit world and also a beautiful outcome in your sleep state.
In your sleep state, yeah.
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 So there's the warning.
Yeah.
I feel, though, that there's a really, the encouragement is even more important.
Yes.
On Earth, there is so much disillusionment about love. There is so much feeling that what's the point in loving? I'm only going to get harmed by it. What's the point in giving your heart? You only get hurt. What's the point in loving other people? Nobody honors you. Nobody respects you. What's the point in being in a, you know, loving with each individual? Because they never do what you want. Mm-hmm. There's all this, what's the point? There's all this disillusionment. There's all this feeling of, you know, of unresolved questions and no answers. And there's all this feelings that what's the point of even doing anything in harmony with love, right? And what Afra is trying to say in this chapter is there is a huge point to doing everything in harmony with love while you're on Earth. Because not only does your spirit life improve immediately every night, but your spirit life after you've passed will be so different than what it could have been if you don't act in harmony with love. He's trying to give you the encouragement as well, say, even though you go through hardship here, even though when you're, you know, when you try to do the loving thing and you get attacked or you get belittled or somebody laughs at you or somebody treats you badly as a result of you just trying to be a better person and you just trying to love, even though that's happened here, there will be the rewards for every one of those events in the spirit world for you.
Yeah.
And that you need to remember that here.
Mm-hmm.
it's no good giving up the memory of that. Because when you give up the memory of that, you give up everything, and you give up hope, and you give up desire, and you give up love.
Yeah.
And that is the dangerous thing about our choices here. As soon as we give up hope, as soon as we give up faith in love, now it's highly likely that we're going to give up a lot in our future as a result.
And this is something, again, I'll just call it the gift of Afra writing this book and the gift of this chapter.
Mm.
He so transparently shows us, he's so open and humble to show, look, I was driven to the point of atheism. Mm. I could not understand why people were being punished for other people's sins. I felt disillusioned about this whole process and about my creator, really.
Mm.
And through this experience of remembering my sleep state, my relationship with God grew. I understood his nature and his qualities more. Really, he's saying that in this chapter, I feel.
Yeah.
And this is the gift to us. And I would encourage anyone who's grappled with a lot of the things that we're talking about disillusionment and about facade and things like that,
mm.
to really, you have the opportunity to engage with this chapter and to feel about what's being presented to you, and that can touch your heart in terms of not only having hope and faith in love, but also in God,
mm-hmm.
And God, the way God's created everything.
So we probably need to say to the audience at this point that there are many warnings contained in this chapter, but there are also many beautiful encouragements contained in this chapter.
Yeah.
And if we're self-reflective when we read a book like this, we can actually look at the warnings and go and ask ourselves questions about the warnings that are given. How am I in my day-to-day life, how am I choosing to act here on earth and also in my sleep state? How aware am I of what is really going on in terms of condition of love? What am I doing? And should I choose to do unloving things, I need to become aware of the results of doing those unloving things. But also, there's this other beautiful factor, isn't there? And that is, we would like to encourage every person to understand this basic truth that's presented here. The basic truth is that when you act in harmony with love, there are benefits not only now, not only in your sleep state, but for your life from then on, forever, by your acting in harmony with love now. Don't let the disillusionment of the world affect how you act in harmony with love.
Yeah.
And don't let the beliefs of this unreal world that we live in affect your decision to live in disillusionment and therefore choose to do the same things that people in this world generally choose to do. And I just love some of the things right in the conclusion.
Yes,
perhaps that would be nice to read.
Yeah.
He says, when the hour of mourning calls you back to earth, how frequently do the echoes of your last assurance continue to ring within your ears? Quit you like men, be strong. I'm not sure why it says it like that, but arise and keep your compact in spirit and in letter before the weight of your perjury grows too heavy for your soul to bear. And ye who weep, look up, hush the voice of your mourning and dry your moistened eyes. The loved ones have not gone away. Their kisses are still lingering in freshness upon your lips. And he's just reminding people that even when our friends die, every night, you get to meet them.
Yeah.
You have lost nothing, actually, except the memory of your last night.
Yeah.
And if we became more, if we work through more of our emotional condition, we won't even lose that.
Yeah.
We will remember every night, every night's sleep, every night being awake, we will remember. And we will remember everything that we experienced in our sleep state. And the beauty of that is that it's going to provide a lot of encouragement as long as we chose, like Afra chose.
Yeah.
As long as we chose to use our will on earth in harmony with love, then we'll be especially happy about our choices when we reach our spirit world state.
Yeah.
But if we choose to live our life out of harmony of love, we're not going to be very happy either in our sleep state or in our life after we pass.
Yeah. That's probably a good place to leave our discussion.
Yeah, possibly.
Yeah. I have a couple more. I was trying to formulate some homework for our viewers as well.
Yes.
So I've done that, and I might just read that out.
Sure. Sounds good.
So these are really just points for reflection or journaling. And this is what I have. Fred had few true friends on earth because he refused to compromise his morals or beliefs while he was on earth. This moral development, however, meant that he gained many friends in spirit during his sleep state after he passed. So for you at home, consider the effect of compromising while on earth and the impact this has on who we associate with both here and in the spirit world. Over the next week, notice when you compromise your morals and beliefs and why you do it. Is it to keep company or approval of others who don't share your morals? And if so, consider the impact this has upon your soul condition.
Hmm. Oh, that's a good question. We see it happening all the time, of course, don't we? Where we see people express privately to us their beliefs and then we observe them more publicly expressing almost completely the opposite thing.
Yes.
and obviously that has a degradation to the condition.
Yeah, it does. Mm. And it's an issue of fear oftentimes, but it is still something that's very much within our control, not to present that facade or to compromise on our morals.
Many of us are so afraid of being different, aren't we? Mm-hmm. And we need to deal with that too.
Yeah.
In the sleep state, your differences are honoured.
Yeah.
In your on earth, often here, any differences are beaten into submission, and this is another one of the unrealities versus the realities of the spirit world. Yeah. So it's going to be. I feel as we discuss more and more of these books and we start helping people reflect a little bit more about their personal life. We had a comment made, though, this week, didn't we, about the book and about these books, about reflection that we discussed a bit, you and I, that I'd probably just like to finish on. And that is, we can read a book like this as a book. Mm-hmm. And we go, oh, yeah, I read that book. It's a fascinating book. And it has no, and can have no impact whatsoever on our day-to-day life. Or we can read the book with a lot of humility and self-reflection. And what we'd like to encourage you, the reader of these books, because we would like to discuss not only through the Mist book, but also the other two books in the Robert James Lee series, what we'd like to encourage you to do is to reread these books with much more self-reflection and humility. And you will find that in doing so, you will learn much more than you thought possible, because these are very, very cleverly conceived books by a spirit who has since become at one with God. And even when he wrote this book, Through the Mist, although he was not yet at one with God, he was still in a very good condition in comparison to any person on earth. And it would, if you can understand this book and understand what is in it, and self-reflect and be humble about it, you can grow a lot in your relationship with God and also a lot in the way in which you reflect love and display love in your day-to-day life. So that's what we would like to encourage you to do.
Certainly. And thanks, Jesus, for joining me for this discussion. And thank you guys for your participation.
So we have Igor behind the camera I'm facing and we have Lena behind the camera we're facing. And also we've started testing out some new equipment, so you can see that there's so many wires around them. We're just trying to test out some new equipment because we're starting to do live video switching, which hopefully will make the editing process a lot easier, and therefore we will be able to get these particular things out more frequently. Also, we're hoping to set up our studio soon, so instead of doing it in Lena and Igor's lounge room as we are currently, we hope to have a more professional studio where we can do a lot more of these recordings and have a bit more of a variety of backgrounds and so forth in the future. So hopefully we can achieve that in the next few months.
Yeah, that'd be great. But I do think Lena and Igor have done amazing things to make their living room look very professional, actually.
Yes. Yeah. So we'd like to thank them both for helping us with that endeavour.
Yeah.
So good luck following and being more self-reflective in reading the book through the mist.
Through the mist, yeah.
Thank you for your time today.